Okay, yes. Well, first, who are we? I guess if you go on Zoom and you put like the speaker situation, so you only see the person who's speaking, you're gonna be seeing mainly us three. Otherwise, we're gonna be lost in the gallery. But yes, we're from David. I'm Nellie. I'm an ACD, a copywriter. And then I have my two colleagues here. Introduce yourselves.
Hi, my name is Sergio. I'm an ACD. I'm an art director from an art background. So Nellie's partner. Very happy to be here.
And I'm Vanessa. I'm a senior strategist and excited to chat with you.
So we're from David, one of the agencies in Miami. So I'm assuming most of you are in Miami. So it's really good that you guys have, you know, an agency like David in Miami, which is not a city that's traditionally known for, you know, advertising. And it's a shame. Well, I wish there's more agencies now blossoming, but David is one of the ones that people mention the most when you think about Miami and the creative hub and where the winning awards and things like that. So it's really a privilege to be working at David and, you know, to have this in our city. And David, the agency, comes from the Ogilvy Group. And the idea is that David Ogilvy, which is the founder of Ogilvy, so this is kind of like a creative spin-off of Ogilvy, because we are smaller. That's one of the things about David, but the whole concept of David is to being a first name agency. So that's why we use the first name of David Ogilvy instead of his last name, which the other people do. We use the David instead of the Ogilvy. So that's the idea. We're kind of like approachable. We're the agency that you call when you want to do something quick and interesting, the agency that does the things that media talks about. So that's the reasoning behind David existing as an agency, is to be that agency that does work that is different from the other big agencies that are out there. I don't know if I said too many times the word agency, but that's the main idea, that why David exists, and we're not just, you know, part of the Ogilvy if we're the same thing. No, we're not the same. We're kind of like this special spin-off agency from them.
Yeah, but we're smaller, so that means that we are more agile, and we can pull some stuff faster than like these big agencies. And sometimes we joke that we move at speed of David, because it's everything so quick and dirty, and we do it things that are pretty impactful in short time, so to speak.
And because of that idea that we're like this first person agency, that this is kind of like our mantra, and Vanessa is going to talk a little bit more about it.
Yeah. So at David, we believe in the power of intimacy. It's a principle that we live by. It's in everything that we do, whether that is between agency and clients, when we work together very openly, we bring our clients into the kitchen with us. We have those candid conversations with them and have true collaboration coming out of that. Whether that is intimacy between brands and people, through ensuring that we stay relevant in people's lives. Whether that is intimacy between brands and people, between the agency and our people, by having ideas come out of anywhere, come from anyone at any level, and also between our people and the people out there, because just like in our personal lives, it takes intimacy to feel what is being said before it's actually said. And people at David have really their pulse and culture, and they can grasp conversations before they become too hot. So with this concept of intimacy, it allows us to talk about business problems, not just briefs. You know, clients don't come to us just with a brief and we take it and that's it. We like to go and to discuss everything and to make sure that we're addressing what needs to be addressed. We can shape pop culture instead of just responding to it. It allows us to build relationships for the long run and ultimately bring long-term growth to the agency.
Cool. And thinking about still the idea of intimacy, we have four principles that we work with when we're thinking on ideas. And this is, you know, this is agency culture basically, but structured in ways that we can see in a slide. But first of all, collaboration is the way. So because we're so small, we can easily talk to other departments. We can, you know, call our production friends, say, hey, how can we make this work with this money? We can talk to the account people so they can understand, we can understand better what the client point of view is, and that it's all to make the creative better. And collaboration between all departments is really important for us. Second one, stay hungry. And this is, you know, it should be a rule for everything. Great is okay, and even great can be improved. So how do we make this idea? If it's really good, how do we make it big? If it's really big, how do we make it relevant? So there's always something that you can do to the idea to make it even better. And that's what we're always thinking about. Craft is mandatory, of course. And this is tricky because sometimes we need to do things that are fast, but because they're done quick, it doesn't mean that they can be done, you know, half-assed. They need to be full-assed all the time. So, sorry, my vocabulary. And so that's the idea. Well, make things beautiful. Write the script that, you know, is that touches people emotionally. And just craft is mandatory. And 100% hands-on is that idea that, you know, you're on a brief, you own the brief, it's your brief, you need to deliver, you need to have an idea that's yours, that you had, and well, you and the collaboration with the other departments, but it's like everybody has to be accountable for the work that they're on and to make it happen. There's no coasting, basically. You need to be involved with the project.
Yeah, and throughout the years, David has grown into five different countries. We have five offices, and we got a bunch of global brands that we are agency of records, but we also work with some local brands from Spain, Argentina, Brazil, and Colombia. So this is an overview of the accounts and sort of clients that we work with. And throughout the years, we managed to have the privilege to win some awards with those clients. And it's a relationship built with time. And it's something that that we, both the agency and clients, were aligned and got recognized. So this is the result of many years of work and applying the agency culture of collaboration and all the firsts and the all intimacy talk that we talked about. This is the result in terms of awards, but also in business growth and visibility for all the professionals in the agency. And I believe that creativity and awards, they do leverage the business, and bringing awards home, we get more phone calls from clients and people are more inspired to do great work. So it's a moving gear that pushes both agencies, both agency and clients forward.
Yep. And we feel like, well, I did Miami at school, Vanessa did Miami at school too. And I remember that whenever people did, you know, did talks, it was always interesting to hear, how did we end up here? You know, how did we get at David? What's our career story? Because sometimes it can inspire you guys to think about, you know, what's your situation? How can you move around and navigate all the opportunities that you have? So we're just gonna, you know, tell our stories.
Yeah, and I'll get us started. My journey actually has been nowhere close to a straight line. I come from a very small town in Brazil. And I went to school in upstate New York, and had no idea what I wanted to do with my life. So from graduating and thinking about what now, I decided to try something that was broad enough for me to see if I liked it. And I started in consulting. I worked at PwC. I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with that firm, but it was very finance oriented. I spent a lot of hours on Excel and knew that that wasn't for me. So what I did next was I moved to the Middle East for the adventure of it. And while I was there, I pursued my master's and I got into agency life. And I did that all kind of at the same time. So it was a bit chaotic. You guys are pursuing your master's now, so you can imagine what that was like. But as I was writing my master's thesis, I was citing David in it and being not so secretly jealous of the amazing work that they were doing in Miami. And what happened at the same time was that I was in the account department, and I was a little bit jealous of the planners in the agency as well, because I felt like my skills were really in sync with what they were doing. So next, I moved to Miami, and I was looking into moving into to the strategy department, and I went to Miami Ad School for the boot camp, and that was what allowed me to transition. I kind of started from scratch all over again at David, starting from intern and then growing from there and getting to work on a lot of amazing projects and clients within the agency, and getting all of that experience of living in a bunch of different places, of trying a bunch of different things, have helped build what I am as a planner and my ability to relate to people and bring that to help me at my job. So that was a little bit of my path. I think Sergio is next.
Yeah, so coincidence, we're all Brazilian. I started my career in a local market in Brazil, kind of by accident, because when I graduated advertising school, I didn't know what to do and started working on a design firm. So I started doing this merchandising stuff for HSBC, the local HSBC. So it's kind of a humble beginning doing posters and displays and leaflets. And then I got to know the advertising people that did work for HSBC. And that's when the agency life opened up for me. And then from this local market in a city that was called Curitiba, I moved to São Paulo. And then I started working at Ogilvy. And David, since it's a sister agency from Ogilvy, during the period that I was in São Paulo, I started working between offices. And long story short, I ended up being hired in Miami. And I had the opportunity to work with great people, very inspiring people, a lot of creatives from different backgrounds that went through my life in both at Ogilvy and at David. And it's always, I always try to take the most of them and learn everything that I could. And it's really amazing. It's a privilege to have this experience of passing in all these different stages of life, working with these different creative people, and that's what we are now. And we try to get this. We try to pass it on all our experience to our younger teams, and hopefully. We're doing it right and trying to keep the creative flame alive for everyone.
Good. Okay, my turn. Surprise, I'm from Brazil too. And I started working advertising in, again, a little city in Brazil. And Brazil is interesting because there's only one place to work in advertising, which is São Paulo, the biggest, biggest city in the country. And I didn't really want to live there. So I worked in my city for, 6-7 years almost, doing humble beginnings, pamphlets, writing headlines for emails and stuff like that, really exciting. And I just saw the work being done everywhere. And I was like, I want to do something cool. I don't want to do this. And I had a bunch of friends who had done Miami Ed School in Brazil, but I didn't want to go to São Paulo. So I decided to just do it in the States. You know, why not? If I have to do Miami Ed School, why not do it in Miami? So I moved to Miami and I felt like really awkward because I was, you know, older than the students that were just coming out of high school, college, and I had already worked a bunch of years and like, what am I doing here? You know, kind of starting all over. But, you know, I gave it my all and I tried to listen to the advice that people gave me. And I remember a talk that Pippa gave at Miami Ed School, I think at the beginning, she was explaining how the internships worked. You know, you have to do 4 internships, blah, 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 because I did the portfolio path. So it's 2 full years. And she said, the last internship, do it at the agency that you want to work at, because then you can, you know, hustle your way into getting hired. So I was like, okay, let me remember that. So when it was time to figure out the last internship I wanted to do, I decided it was going to be David. So I had to do the full 2 years because they only allowed me to take David at the last quarter of the program. But I did Y&R, I did McCann, I did only 3, and then David was the last one. So I was like, okay, I'm going to get hired at David no matter what. So I did my best, you know, it's like I presented ideas proactively. I tried to show interest in every project and, you know, really live the culture of the agency. And at the very end, I had an offer to go to Y&R actually, but I really wanted to stay at David. I didn't want to leave. So I went to the management at David and I was like, look, I really want to stay, but I have this other offer. And, you know, do you want to give me an offer too so I can stay instead of leaving? And they did that. So it was a little bit exciting because it was the last day. The last day of my internship, they made me an offer. And I have been at David ever since. So I started as an intern and I'm now an ACD. And it was really fast. It was really fast growth, but I had previous experience. So it's, you know, it might take a little bit longer for somebody who's never worked in advertising before, but David was the agency that allowed me to grow that fast because everything happened so fast. So there's lots of projects, there's awards that you win because you're helping on a project. So it's all that, it's everything really fast, but you know, that's why I wanted to tell my story this way with the internship part, because that's really important if you're in a creative field. Leverage all your connections because you never know what person is going to have an opening that's going to, you know, email you one day and then you get a job. So show your best every time because you never know who's going to offer you a job someday. And yeah.
And just to elaborate on that point that Nellie just made, we both have that connection of Miami Ad School. And now you have Sergio's connection as well. So, and we all love to pay it forward. So make sure that you connect with us afterward and keep in touch, because then whatever it is that we can do to help you, we most certainly will. And we love to get to make sure just that we are as valuable to you as other people have been to us in the past.
Yeah, that's true. I wish I had connections when I started. When I started, it was hard to get a portfolio school. So Miami Ed School, I don't even think they were in Brazil yet, but it was really hard. And it's hard to figure out by yourself and just make the most of your connections. LinkedIn is something amazing. And please reach us out. We're friendly. We're this tiny person on the screen, but we're real people. We talk with you. We're very happy to help.
Yep. So let's talk about ideas now. We brought a bunch of case studies of, you know, our the ideas that we have worked on that are, you know, notable from David. There's many, many more, but some of them we haven't worked on them. So we thought it wasn't, you know, we don't have the insight knowledge that makes a presentation fun. So we just brought the ones that we worked with. And yes, so we can start with this one because I feel like this one is the most recent bigger one. Oh, and just a note on the QR codes, we're gonna show a case study on the second slide, but you know, sometimes on Zoom, it's not the best to see videos. So if you feel like the experience is really not the best, you mute your computer, you scan the code and watch it on your phone, and then we come back later and talk about it. So go, Sergio, this one is yours.
Yeah, well, okay. So this one is an idea that was a group effort that involved a lot of people, a lot of brain power, but it's something that it first came out like 4 or 5 years ago. And when we first presented to Burger King, they were curious. They got this, they were scared in a way, but it wasn't really the time for them because they didn't have removed everything, all the preservatives from food. So it would be a false claim, so to speak. But I was cooking in a slow burner for a few years, and then a couple other agencies showed this idea to Burger King. And when more than one people tell you the idea, it starts getting bigger and bigger. And it's something that the client was really brave to show their product in this light, because it's something that if you think no one would like to showcase the best product in a gross way. So that's what we think, that the client was brave, but he was backed by a lot of people. So I think different agencies, because we did this with, it was between David Ingo and Publicis Madrid, I guess. Yeah, Publicis. And it was kind of a group effort to convince client to make this happen. And I'm glad that he believed and that he listened for other creatives, and it was a bold move because franchisees, they didn't like this at all. But in the end, it paid off. Even though McDonald's had removed like preservatives years ago, Burger King was the one from the guest point of view is the one that removed everything first. So this is one of the few ideas that when you stop and think, it's something crazy that we pulled this off. But we're so glad that the client did this and it got the recognition it deserved. And I think it was the most awarded campaign from last year. So I hope you guys watch the video. It's in the QR code. So it tells a bit more of the story. And looking from a business point of view, it was a hit. It sold a lot of Whoppers, and perception changed it, and Burger King was shifting this perception of an antiquated QSR into a more modern business, and with, you know, with innovative ingredients and the way that they're dealing with their product. And I have, hey, Vanessa, you know how much more Whoppers that we sold, like a percentage of it?
Yeah, it was an increase of 14% in sales. And then besides sales, which is really important, it also was a very big lift in food quality perception of like 26%. And then around 23% more visitation consideration to our stores. So it was this amazing idea that got a lot of talkability, but it also got very solid results to our client. And we're very proud of that.
Yeah, it's just one of those cases that creativity works well with business and pushes everything forward. And it kind of leveraged it put the other restaurants in a bad light because they have to do better. Everyone had to do better and talk about the preservatives and all the stuff, the nasty stuff that they put on the food. So it wasn't that momentum when everyone was questioning, and gladly we pulled this off at the right time in the best way possible. So really proud of that. And it's not unusual that clients ask for an idea like that, but I don't think that many clients would approve an idea like this one, because it's really bold, and it's really asks a lot from the client to pull one thing like that. That's the merit of having different agencies and different people convincing the client to make this happen.
We want to play we try to see the video on the next one. Okay, so people be ready, scan the code just to have it ready in case the playback is not the greatest for the Zoom. Cool. Let's try to see this.
Fast food, an industry that offers convenient, craveable food at a good value. But
you put out a bag and you can keep it there forever, right?
It's right here.
No fungus, no mold, no smell.
Why is there no mold on that?
Well, because of all the stuff we put in our food.
What we put in our bodies.
It's time to change that.
What a difference a day made.
Burger King is rethinking the image of its signature Whopper burger.
They're turning a lot of heads with a new ad, and maybe some stomachs too.
Showing that mold can be a beautiful thing.
It shows a moldy Whopper as a way to announce that the fast food chain will no longer put preservatives in their food.
The beauty
of no artificial preservatives.
I think it's great. It's very risky, but I think it's a really neat commercial.
It's fascinating and gross at the same time. When I watch this, I'm like, I can't unsee this, but also I can't stop watching it.
When one company makes a decision like this, it certainly have ripples effects across the whole industry.
So is this really the best way to sell a burger?
Well, I know the difference in you.
Look, they're taking out preservatives. This is the real deal.
I think it really speaks to the fact that companies are hearing this huge tectonic shift of customers asking real questions about what's in their food.
They're removing preservatives because they feel real food tastes better.
The difference is you.
Oh, answering Grisella's question about how this idea came to life. At first, we came across these images of the cheeseburgers, or mummified cheeseburgers that people forgot in their cars or in their closets, and years later they still look the same. And we weren't in a time that the tone of voice, the BK's tone of voice, was constantly picking on McDonald's, because we were an underdog. We were a challenging brand, so we were challenging the biggest. And that's where we were at first, like the first time we presented. But years later, when Burger King actually removed the artificial ingredients, suddenly the idea came back into discussion, and that's when it got traction and it came to life. So it was an insight from the competitor, because it was McDonald's put a lot of nasty stuff in their food, and that's why it still looks the same, because it has like this concern of shelf life. So the it's just crazy how food looked the same years after it was forgotten in the closet. So that's where the insight was born. And Burger King being without preservatives, it would rot, it would mold, it would get nasty. So the line that we use at the end, that's the beauty of real food, that it rots. So that's the beauty, because it doesn't have any preservatives. So that's straight on the brief, and that's why it closed the full circle, like the acid, the inside, and everything else.
Yep. And another interesting one about this is that, you know, it's an idea that breaks the mold of what food advertisement usually is. You know, everybody always shows the food in the best light, really appetizing, really delicious looking. And this is why this was so shocking, because it's like the opposite of that, but it's for a good point. You know, it's not gratuitous. We're making a point that the food looks ugly, but that's because it's better for you. So that's part of what makes this interesting too.
Yeah, it flips a negative into a positive in a very beautiful way. But I wanted to check with you guys before we go on to the next one, if there are any questions about this, like if you want to talk about moldy a little bit, we can do that. Because I know that there was some conversation in the chat. Just
was this produced at David, or do you guys mostly outsource media like this?
This was produced by a Swedish photographer, because the agency that led production is an agency called Ingo from Sweden, and they commissioned this photographer to study how to make this happen. And funny thing is that mold, there are unique types of mold from different countries, so you wouldn't get this type of mold here in the US or anywhere else. So I think they left the Whopper rotting at the studio for 30 or 40 days, if I'm not wrong. But it took a lot of time, a lot of study, because they had to have the perfect combination of moisture. So it was real food, but it had some cinema magic, you know, so to speak. It had some production, because you have to keep the temperature and the moist and the humidity. Everything has to be controlled to get the best result. They rotted a ton of Whoppers, so these are the best ones.
Oh, should we do the next one?
Cool. Okay, let me this.
So this one is Stevenage Challenge, and I'll talk to you guys about that. But I'm thinking maybe we watch the case study. Yeah, yeah, let's.
It's a good idea.
Confused? Let me take you back a few steps. You haven't heard of Stevenage Football Club, right? Well, neither had we. But we realized that even though they're at the bottom of England's fourth division, they were going to appear in the same video game that all the expensive players were going to be in. And that's when, almost 2 years ago, we decided to sponsor Stevenage. Because if we put our logo on their real shirt, we would definitely have our logo in the game. Introducing the Stevenage Challenge. Gamers across the world immediately started choosing Stevenage, signing the best players to our team and playing with them. For every goal they shared on Twitter, go, go, go. we gave them rewards. The news took the gaming community by storm.
The best gifts in the game, the Stevenage, they have Burger King as their sponsor.
Oh, Lawrence. Oh, my God. Football, food, what could possibly be better?
Il est trop beau, les gars, vite.
Just like that. Our small team in real life turned into the biggest team online. So, gamers chose the best players in the world to play for Stevenage.
So this idea is called the Stevenage Challenge, and it all started with BK wanting to connect with the gaming community, and to do that in a way that goes beyond just like common partnerships that we see in the gaming space. And we know from consumer behavior that if you're in a game and you're seeing advertising happening in game, if it's disturbing your experience, then it backfires. You know, you want to make sure that the brand that's there, it's either is adding to your experience. Otherwise it gets really disrupting in your pastime. What we did was we know that FIFA is one of the most popular games in general. And in a lot of our global markets, it's the most played game. And they were going to launch it with these amazing graphics. And we know that if a brand wanted to sponsor a player like Cristiano Ronaldo or Messi or Neymar, they would have a millions and millions of dollars. NBK has this challenger brand mentality, as we know, and we were thinking, how can we do that in a challenger way? So what Burger King did was we sponsored Stevenage, which is a small club in England in the fourth division. And how does that bring us any closer to Messi is through the game, because if like they are in the fourth division, that means they are in FIFA. So Burger King put like this logo nice and big in Stevenage's jersey. And that meant that when people were playing FIFA, they could play through Stevenage and then hire the best players. And we had the Stevenage Challenge, which they could win free food by scoring certain ways with the players, and they would record the move that they did and post it online. So like people are getting all of these videos of Neymar scoring and celebrating wearing a BK jersey, and they're winning free food through that. And it was this gaming partnership that happened in a very organic way. It added fun to the game for people. And something really interesting in terms of results, because Spain was one of the main markets where this activation happened. And in Spain, FIFA is the most popular game. And 60% of the free food, like the codes that they used, were redeemed. And the way that it worked was you had a minimum spend and you could use one at a time. So that meant that it was this fun activation that happened online, but drove results because it drove 60% of the coupons back to the store and making sure that people did win food, but they also had to purchase food while at BK. So it also drove amazing results to our clients. And any questions about Stevenage at all?
I think I can add while Gastic on questions. I'm not part of this idea, but I really like is the long game of it. You know, like 2 years before implementing the promotion, you had to sponsor the team, to wait for the game to be developed, to be the logo be on the jersey, and then finally you could, you know, activate the idea. And the insight is so simple and it's clever. It could have come from anybody who plays the game, you know? So thinking in terms of, you know, where insights come from and how do creative ideas, come to exist. It's just like looking at the things that you do and your pastimes, you know, maybe this came from a person who was just playing the game and was like, huh, I wonder if we sponsored any team, we would be on the game without paying for it. So that's, you know, it's the simple little ideas that can become really impactful if they're really clever.
Yeah, and David, we have this hacker mentality. We always try to hack or find like loopholes or ways that we can be creative without breaking the bank. So with this mentality, it's something that took like a behavior from people that were already doing this at home, and people share their best moments. And it's something that it's really a building block, and getting this behavior and getting this loophole, and it all came into this amazing idea that also took many years to go live. But it's something that it's nice to keep an eye on what people are doing and the current culture, and how can we bring that into the creative process and bring in having an insight from that, because everything in the end is a building block.
Yeah, and I think if there's a lesson to be taken from these two first ideas that we shared with you, is don't give up on your ideas. You know, if you have them, and if it takes whatever it takes to make them happen, like if it takes bringing them back, if it takes waiting for the conditions to like allow you to make it, but don't give up on your ideas, and it can happen even if it's years later. We have
I did. Hi, everyone. Thanks for speaking to us. I'm Jacobia. But my question is kind of about social listening and how that kind of works for the agency. Because in some briefs, like you mentioned, this is particularly for gamers. And sometimes with a smaller agency or even in any agency, the groups that are created, maybe you don't have necessarily a personal touch with gaming or whatever the brief is based on. So do you have any tips for social listening and how we can get connected and kind of in the world of what the brief is asking for?
Yeah, so I think like when you're working for an agency, which was different than when I was doing my assignments for Miami Ad School, you have certain tools that allow you to do social listening in a much easier way. But even if you don't have those tools, it's still, it takes a lot of like labor of love to go in and do it manually, but you can, and it's really important. It's something that we do for any of our briefs, especially the ones that are very digital heavy. But I think like nowadays, like anything is digital, right? So we make sure that we are listening to the people that is our target audience even before we do it, and then throughout the campaign to see how they are responding to it and how we can amplify based on the reactions that we're getting online.
Yeah. Well, I mean, from the point of view of creative, I really don't feel the difference, you know, when I was in my med school and now. I still Google the same, just like I love Reddit, Twitter, and Googling the stuff. If it's a subject that's really foreign to me, then maybe I need to rely more on, you know, the research that we always get research from our partners that do social listening. They send, you know, keywords and da 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 and a bunch of things that we use, but there's nothing like Googling it yourself. So you can read everything and think about it and filter it yourself. So at the end of the day, it's a lot of, like Vanessa said, it's labor of love. You need to immerse yourself in the thing, in the subject. I'm not a gamer, so I'm not sure if I would have had this idea, because how would I know that? Well, maybe because you could see a picture of the game and have the same insight. Yeah, it's, I don't know, it's research, a lot of it.
Yeah, a lot of Googling But the first days of every brief, it's when we, because as creatives, we try to dig deep into a subject and we try to go as deep as possible. And that's sometimes it's really down there that there lays the best ideas and the best insights. And we usually use the research and all, but we do a lot of stuff by ourselves. And I think that's the cool part of this job, is that you get to be a specialist in whatever you're working on. It so it's be a finance, or it's gaming, or it's a yogurt some sort, you have to dig deep and get to know what all the people, all the other agencies are doing, and what are people are talking about. And it involves like a lot of research. And but everyone is digital native now, so it's something that's it's easy these days. You just have to look in the right places.
Yeah, and the thing about Googling, like we've been talking about, and using our tools to get insights, is that every agency has access to that. So it's about the feeling, it's about getting those conversations as they start before anyone else acts on it. So like that is very important as well, because we can like we all know about like Gen Z and their behavior, like gaming, we know those very basic things, everyone does. So like what is the one like specific behavior that is happening right now that nobody activated on yet, that we can do it and we can amplify? So it's very important, the timing, and also the like being daring and going for something that is a little bit in the fringe of it, because that's how you make something that's unique.
Yeah, because the ideas are out there, they're floating for everyone to pick it. And I think what makes a good idea is how you combine things, and how you pick something that it's current and people are talking about, and try to match it with your product and your brief. And that's when that's what the craft of our trade is about. How we put these things together and make it interesting. So that's you build with experience, but that's the way that we always try to approach our briefs and try to solve the client's problems.
Yep. Okay. Let's see the next one. So this one is for Budweiser. It's the Super Bowl spot of 2019, I think. But what's cool about it is not just the spot, it's the whole thought process behind it. So I'm gonna do like we did on the last one, play the video first, and then I'll go back and talk about how it came to life.
Now to a dire warning about climate change. Sorry, so this is what we've already done, right? We've warmed the planet since 1900.
Climate change is a serious problem we can't ignore. As one of the largest breweries in the U.S., Budweiser believes we are responsible for doing our part to help. So we became the first major beer brand in the U.S. to brew with 100% wind power. To make that happen, we built our own Budweiser wind turbine farm at Thunder Ranch in Oklahoma, so that every single Budweiser from across our 12 breweries is now brewed with 100% wind power. We also created a symbol to stamp our commitment in every beer we produce, so we could spread this message to the world. But this was bigger than our beer. So to inspire others and start a global conversation about clean energy, we launched this initiative with a beautiful and inspiring spot in the biggest stage of all, the Super Bowl. But we didn't just stop there. We literally brought wind power to the Super Bowl as well.
Budweiser is helping power the Super Bowl all the way in Atlanta.
The company announced it plans to offset 100% of the energy used to power Super Bowl weekend with clean, renewable energy.
And even our outdoor ads were powered by the wind, too. We invited other brands to adopt our symbol to represent their own commitment to clean energy. By switching to renewable energy, We led the way, and other breweries all over the world joined in our commitment, making a huge global impact.
Yes, how many deaths will it take?
Because of our commitment, the world started talking about the importance of renewable energy from wind power. But more importantly, our movement is already removing 300,000 tons of CO2 per year, the equivalent of more than 700,000 cars from the road in the next 10 years. It was never just about brewing an eco-friendly beer. It was also about brewing a better tomorrow.
So this is a really interesting project because, of course, we didn't have the idea of brewing the beer with wind power. That was the client. You know, they took that initiative of converting all their breweries into wind power. But they came to us for the Super Bowl spot. They actually didn't really tell us what they wanted to say with the Super Bowl spot exactly. So the Super Bowl is this, it's a big monster. Every year, every agency is like thinking about the Super Bowl. And the first challenge of the Super Bowl is thinking about what you want to say. It's not always that clear what you want to say, because some brands just want to entertain, perhaps. Maybe we wanted to talk about, you know, the taste of the beer, or, you know, there's many things that you can say. Budweiser has a big history of doing Super Bowl spots that are story based and doesn't really talk about the product at all. You know, we had the puppy with the horse, and the horses are a big part of it. So when the project came to us and we found out that they had this initiative of, you know, brewing with wind power, we thought it was a great opportunity to highlight that, because it's the moment to talk about what they're actually doing. So there's a lot of controversy on greenwashing too in the advertising industry. Some companies got caught, you know, recently claiming that they were doing more than they were. So it's a touchy subject, but this is real. They are actually brewing with wind power to this day. So why not just talk about it in the biggest stage of the world? And then the challenge became, okay, how do we say that in a spot without being boring? We need people to like this. We need people to think it's fun. And the audience for Budweiser is a really, you know, at average, all everyday American. They're not necessarily interested in knowing about green initiatives. They're watching the Super Bowl, they're having fun, and they like Budweiser because it's traditional. So it was a really tight rope we needed to navigate. So that's why, you know, changing a traditional brand's perception, because we needed to introduce this modern thing about Budweiser, but without losing our roots. So that's the tricky part. So that when the spot came to life, you know, we have the horses with our traditional, we have a cute puppy, which people love, but also we showed the message of the windmills, and by using the song by Bob Dylan, it all tied together with this feeling of being, we're just helping the country, we're helping the world, and this is the Budweiser that you know and love, and it's not changing, but we're actually changing. I don't know if that makes sense. Where did the idea come from for the spot was from the brand itself. We looked at what the brand did every year with the horses, the Clydesdales, and, you know, what did people expect from the brand, and how can we tweak it a little bit? We want to give them something that they can recognize as Budweiser, but not the same as they've seen every year. So, and that's how this spot came to life. And we feel like the whole campaign was really interesting because we also, we gave this idea we gave to the client to help power Atlanta, so the city of Atlanta that the Super Bowl was in, with electric energy too, with the, you know, renewable energy. So they donated, like, it's a complicated thing, but they donate the energy to the city, so then they don't need to get energy from the power plant, whatever. And so Budweiser literally powered the Super Bowl as well. So it was the whole package. You know what, when in school sometimes they say, like, oh, you need to come up with a 360 campaign, da 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 da, and sometimes you're like, oh no, that sounds exhausting. But it's really important because then you can show how every idea works towards the same purpose, but they're not the same idea. They're ideas that complement each other, you know, the flags that were the billboards, quote unquote, and then the powering of the city. You can create several ideas that work towards the same purpose and make everything cohesive.
Yeah, that's what they call it, a platform idea, when you get so many extensions and lines and show how far the idea can go, and it can be replicated in different mediums. So that's when we try and like exhaust and stress the idea, and we see the full potential and how it comes to life in different ways.
And then I think we want to open for, you know, random questions. I think we talked a lot ourselves. Doesn't need to be about the two participants raised hands. Okay. How do we decide who talks first?
Maybe Nellie, we stop sharing screen and then we can see each other. And
okay, yeah.
Why don't we start with Shanice?
Hello, I'm Shanice. Like Vanessa just said, I'm learning that all agencies are different. So I'm more interested in the workflow at David. So when a brief comes in, what's the process from brainstorming to pitching to like executing? How do strategy teams and creative teams like collaborate?
Yeah, so I can start and then my creative colleagues can come in. So usually the strategy team will get briefed by the client. And a lot of the times, because we are like a very collaborative agency, we bring the creative lead as well to the briefing session so they can hear it firsthand from the client. And then once we get the client brief, we, as in the strategy department, will come up with the creative brief. And once we do, we brief the creative teams and we don't go away. Like, we're still there, we're still talking, we're still sharing insights throughout the process. And then the creatives are thinking on it. And then I'll hand it over to one of the creatives to take the story forward.
Okay, so we get the brief from strategy. We ask a bunch of questions during the meeting. I'm notorious for asking a lot of questions. And afterwards, I don't know, every team is different, but me and Serge, we do a lot of research on our own since now we're remote from each other, ever since pandemic hit. So we just, you know, we just spend our time however we want, Googling, looking for things. If we find something interesting, we send each other whatever. And then at some point we can sit in a call, just us two, and talk about what we found, ideas we had, what we like, we write them down. And then later at some point, we meet with our creative director and discuss all the top level ideas that we have. And he kind of picks what he likes, what we can develop more. And then later in the process, we have an internal with, then we bring in the strategy back, sometimes the account people too, so they can see the ideas in development and kind of comment like, oh, I think this is going to be better this way. I think this one is stronger than the other one. And then we continue developing them to the client presentation. That's kind of how it goes.
Yeah, and every team has a way of approach the brief. I think me and Natalie, we both personally like to have some time on our own at first to do our research and get to know more about the product or the service, whatever we're working on it. So, because we try to get a vocabulary and to get the sort of material to start working with. And so then we can talk to each other and play ball and riff. So it depends on the creative, but because they're creatives to start talking right away, right after the brief. So I personally like to spend more time on our own at the very beginning, and then we talk about it and spend hours on Slack and WhatsApp and Zoom, so we're connected all the time. So ideas, we throw ideas to each other all the time, constantly. That's the magic of working from home.
Hey, Naomi, jump in. Hi, I'm Naomi. I loved all the campaigns that you showed because they are, like you said in the beginning, they're very innovative and they're very fresh. And I like that David takes like an intimate approach to these campaigns. So I know we talked a lot about like researching on your own, but are there any things that you as creative directors or strategists look for to key in on to help further the intimate relationship and the take that you guys have with all your campaigns? Because they're very, even the Burger King one was, you know, so left field. Like, what cued you into, hey, this would be a good idea? Or are there insights that you guys look for to point you in a certain direction? Because it's very unique, very, very unique.
I don't know. I feel like it's the lateral thinking. So for me, it helps to see a lot of other people's ideas. So then you know what is expected, because you know, like, oh, a bunch of people had this idea, a bunch of people are thinking this way, like all agencies do it this way, how can we do it different? Sometimes I literally look at the brief and think like, what can I do that is the opposite of this brief? And I know that's like not a great advice for students, like, but it's kind of like, what is the opposite of what the brief is telling me to do? Because every agency would just answer the brief the way the brief is telling you to answer it. But maybe if you think in reverse, at some point you're going to get to an idea that actually answers the brief, but is left field. But I don't know. It's kind of like, it's a lot, having lots of ideas also helps. Lots of ideas. At some point, yeah, one of them is going to be good.
Yeah, volume. Also, it's a great way to exercise when you start bringing a lot of ideas. You start approaching the problem from different angles. And that's when things start to get interesting. So I think it's important for creatives to dig as deep as you can into the subject and into the brief. And then you start to see things are actually, no one ever did this, or no one ever talked about this in this way or that way. So it's an exercise and it's a numbers game. So try to come up as many ideas as possible. And you just, and you won't lose all the ideas, because I'm going to tell you, because I always keep the ideas that I like and I try to reuse them. So it's something that you may not use it for now, but tomorrow it may be suited for a different brief. So try to get as many ideas as possible, and it's important to see what other people are doing. So try to consume a lot of trade news and look for other agencies' work and other portfolios, other creatives, what they're doing. So that kind of builds your criteria, what's good and what's not. And that's it's something that it takes time to bring your own criteria. But it's also very important for you to know if your idea fits your bar. So, right? So if you think, sometimes I see work that it's live and it wouldn't pass on my criteria, but I don't know, it's just a personal thing. But it's an exercise, and that's a muscle that we should try to exercise more often.
Maria, jump in.
Hi everyone. Well, first of all, thank you so much for your time. I am curious about maybe what's your process when trying to get some interns. I'm not sure what you are exactly looking for of certain people. So,
Well, I don't know how the actual process is nowadays. I'm sure there's like an HR situation and people apply and whatnot. I'm not sure how that goes down, but I can speak about what I'm looking for in portfolios, for example.
Yes, exactly. Thank you.
Well, you know, because interns, I understand they're starting, I'm not looking for fully fleshed, innovative ideas that are going to win Lions tomorrow, or like the craft that's unbelievable. And, you know, I wasn't that way when I was an intern. I don't expect people to be that way. I think what we're looking for is an understanding of what's an idea, of what makes an idea interesting. It can be anything. It can be a headline that's clever. It can be, oh, this idea is kind of bad, but insight is interesting, which means that they know how to find an insight. So it could be anything. It just needs to show different ways of thinking about the problem, like Serge was saying, things that are not the cookie cutter idea. So it doesn't need to be perfect, but it needs to stand out somehow. And that could be in the idea and not necessarily the execution, which I think the idea is most important at the beginning than the execution. I don't know if that answers.
I agree with Nellie. I think the way that you approach a problem and the lateral thinking behind it, I think it's more important than craft and the execution itself. Because when you're starting, you don't have the tools, you don't have the experience, but you have a way to see the world. And that's what I think it's the most important for someone who's beginning in the industry. What is an interesting way to approach the brief? That's the goal, I think.
All right, thank you so much.
Joe?
Hi, good afternoon. Going back to the Burger King commercial, having a great bond with the client is key for an execution of that nature. How do you scan potential new business to make sure your agency is a match with them?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that? I think the audio was kind of iffy. I don't know if I got it.
is it working now?
Yeah.
My bad.
Just raise my volume.
So going back to the Burger King commercial, having a great bond with a client is key for an execution of that nature. How do you scan potential new business to make sure your agency is a good match for them?
Well, it's important to listen to what the client is saying. The Moldy Whopper idea, for example, it existed before the client was ready to make it. And the client told us that. The client was like, look, I love this idea, but I can't do it right now because my sandwich has artificial ingredients still. So let's wait. When my sandwich is clean, then we'll do the idea. And we're like, okay, cool. And we're waiting on our, 3 years to make it happen. So it's a partnership. It's hard because not every client is very good. I'm gonna be honest. Some clients, they're not very clever. Sometimes they don't have the creative chops to understand what a good idea is. Fortunately, our Burger King client at the time, he was amazing. So he actually won like brand genius, I think 3 years in a row. It was like, he was really good. But not every client's like that. So it's a matter of knowing how to make them understand the importance of a great idea. And fortunately, we have our good friends at the account department to help us with that, because they are the ones that mostly build the relationship with client. But I think it's listening to them and trying to make them understand that this is in their best interest. Not every idea is crazy just because we want to be crazy. It's for their business. It's for their brand to grow. And it's a process. It takes time.
Yeah. And I think for new business, Joel, David has a certain reputation for being very creative. So the clients that come to us for potentially working with us know that already. So we can already tell, at least from that first screening, that they, in theory, are open to that kind of work. But then as we develop the relationship with them, as we talk to them more, we ask the right questions, and we are very open about who we are and how we operate. And then we try to feel for that chemistry, and just to make sure that we're the right partners to them and they're the right partners to us. So it's like going back to that intimacy conversation in the beginning. It's just being very open in what we can offer and seeing if that's a good solution for both.
Thank you.
Yeah, and just to add, I think it's a relationship that's built with time, but also with results, because advertising is a very boring business. We often see like the crazy stuff, but it's very rational. So you have to back everything with data, with, you know, so it's boring. And then we have the opportunity to go crazy, and then we get back to being boring, because the craziness is backed by all the rationale, all the data, and all the boring stuff, you know. But it's something that we need to bring results. So and when we constantly bring results, more trust we have from the client, and his ambition starts to grow, and it's something that builds with time. Just to give like a history from the Burger King client, he used to work, his name is Fernando Machado, he used to work at Unilever, so he did Dove sketches. He had a long relationship with the founders of David within Ogilvy. So it's something that throughout the years he was constantly working with the same teams, with the same people, and that's where he got like being at Burger King and with David and bringing this great relationship. The outcome was all those amazing ideas and campaigns that also got really good results.
Thank you.
Maria, jump in.
So hi, everyone. I am Maria. And first of all, thank you very much for your presentation. I loved all your campaigns. And I love this disruptive and unexpected thought in all your campaigns. And well, my question is really similar to the previous one, but I was just really curious about if it's really difficult for you to convince your clients about all your ideas, and if they don't like your ideas or your concepts, do you try to stay loyal to your creativity and your creativity, or you try to adapt to your client?
I think it's both. You know, of course, like Vanessa said, clients that come to us, they know what to expect, kind of. But we also are in the business of making their business grow. So not every brand is going to be crazy in the same way, creative in the same way. So we need to adapt our creativity to the different tones of voice of the different brands and bring them to life in a way that makes sense for that brand. So it's both. We need to stay true to our creative identity, you know, that we do ideas that push the envelope, that we want to make your brand famous and things like that. But we also need to understand their business and their tone of voice and adapt the way we work a little bit. But it's not about just giving them what they want, you know. Otherwise, they could go to any agency, but they're coming to us because they want something special.
Yeah, because otherwise we would be...
You know that your campaigns are creative and disruptive, so...
Yeah.
Yeah, because otherwise we would be just assets suppliers. So I think we have to adapt. It's both things, but we always try to sell our recommendation and what we believe as an agency to what it's best suited for the brief and for creativity and for the business. So it's something that is it's well balanced.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, it was our pleasure. And then we shared our LinkedIn. Make sure to connect with us. If you have any further questions, we're here for you. As Nellie mentioned in the beginning, we're a first name type of agency. So our email is our first name at David Agency. Really easy to get in contact. Thank you all for your time today, for the great questions. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.